This episode is brought to you by Kia's first three-row, all-electric SUV, the Kia EV9. With available all-wheel drive and seating for up to 7 adults, with a 0-60 speed that thrills you 1 minute, and available reclining lounge seats that unwind you the next. Visit kia.com/EV9 to learn more. Ask your Kia dealer for availability. No system, no matter how advanced, can compensate for all driver error and or driving conditions. Always drive safely.
Listen to the 48 Hours podcast for shocking murder cases and compelling real-life dramas from one of television's most watched true crime shows. Go behind the scenes of each episode with award-winning CBS News correspondents and producers in Postmortem, a weekly deep dive. Listen to 48 Hours wherever you get your podcasts.
What the fuck was that?
Not liquor.
White Claw?
White Claw gives me the best podcasting.
Are we recording?
I am now. Yeah, so the situation in the Middle East is, as I was saying, dire.
What did you just suck off there? What was that?
I didn't finish watching this movie, by the way.
Your picks have been horrible, man.
What's the point? It's the point of the show, isn't it? It's possible. I don't understand what this podcast is about.
Poppycock. The fuck house.
On a weekly basis, we are consuming more concentrated bad movies than probably anybody in the history of mankind.
Poppycock.
What story? What are you talking about?
Do you want lunch?
I have yet to laugh in this movie. I'll just tell you that.
You picked it, motherfucker. Just remember that.
You know the problem with Hollywood is? They make shit. Unbelievable, unremarkable shit.
So I was legitimately offended.
You were offended?
I was offended.
I didn't know you could get offended.
I was offended.
This did it.
If I were gay, I wouldn't be offended.
They're fucking making shit up, Amin!
Inconsequential detail after inconsequential detail.
Bees don't lie.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I'm holding a mic in my hands and now I'm talking all over.
Cinephobe, the podcast. We break down the movies you're afraid to admit you love. I'm Zach Harper. That's Amin El Hassan. That's Anthony Mayes. Patreon.com/countthedings for all of our extra bonus content. Make sure you're getting all the holiday episodes, Cinefeud, all that crap. You know what it is.
This month is April, so we got a real special 420 edition.
Woo!
Yeah, won't tell you what the movie is yet, but just know it is a 420 themed special Cinephobe episode.
Isn't Hitler's birthday 420? What if it was a Hitler movie?
Okay. All right. Like, what are you doing? What are you doing right now?
You're keeping everybody on their toes.
No, you're not. You're rabble rousing.
I'm rabble rousing?
You're rabble rousing.
What if I'm review rousing? Because you should leave a review on Apple Podcasts, even if you don't use Apple Podcasts. 5-star review, say whatever you want. Just leave the 5 stars. Make sure you're subscribed and all that stuff, right?
Tell us Hitler's birthday. Who cares?
Yeah, who cares? If you have a submission, submit it. Just needs to be 40% or lower on Rotten Tomatoes for the audience or the critic score. April is Oscar month. In April, we're picking movies that feature people who have won Academy Awards. Amin's pick this week, the 2004 comedy Envy.
Envy.
Oh, there it is. That stinger, yeah.
Envy stars Ben Stiller, Jack Black, and Academy Award winners Rachel Weisz and Christopher Walken.
Christopher Walken.
Watch.
What did Rachel Weisz win?
I'm so glad you asked what Rachel Weisz won. Rachel Weisz won has been nominated twice, in 2006 for Best Supporting Actress for The Constant Gardener, which she won. And she was nominated in 2019 for Best Supporting Actress for The Favorite, which she did not win.
I guess she wasn't the favorite for that one.
Seawalk has been nominated twice as well. He won Best Supporting Actor in 1979 for The Deer Hunter, and he was nominated for Best Supporting Actor in 2003 for Catch Me If You Can.
Walking on broken glass.
I don't know what the reference that was.
Three-time repeat offender, Benny Stills, Ben Stiller, had been in Duplex in 2003, Starsky and Hutch, and former Cinephobe episode Along Came Polly in 2004. Along with Dodgeball, Anchorman, and Meet the Fockers that year.
Big year.
He was a voice in Madagascar, and he was in a Limp Bizkit video in 2005.
He was a fan.
Other Cinephobe episode was Heartbreak Kid.
Oh, yeah.
Jack Black in 2003 was in School of Rock. He also was in Anchorman in 2004, along with Shark Tale and this movie. And then he was in King Kong in 2005.
And Nacho Libre.
Rachel Weisz was in Shape of Things, Confidence, and Runaway Jury in 2003. She was in this movie in 2004. And then Constantine and The Constant Gardener in 2005. Also, she's a repeat offender because she was in Fred Claus.
She was in Fred Claus.
Oh, wow. I forgot.
I forgot about it. And I was writing all these notes about how much I love Rachel Weisz.
Oh, I'm a big fan.
Shout out to her.
And then Walken, also a repeat offender. He was in Gigli in 2003, along with Kangaroo Jack, the original, and The Rundown that year. He was in Man on Fire, this movie, Stepford Wives, and Around the Bend in 2004. And then he was in Wedding Crashers, Romance and Cigarettes, and Domino in 2005.
You got some range for a guy who acts the same way. Like, he's got some range.
He does have some range. And then we also get Amy Poehler, also a repeat offender from Wet Hot American Summer. And she was in Mean Girls in 2004.
Golden Dumpster performance as Regina George's mom. She's so good in that movie, in Mean Girls.
Envy was directed by Barry Levinson.
Pretty big guy.
Barry has had a career. Directed Diner, The Natural, Rain Man, Toys, Disclosure, future Cinephobe, Sleepers, Wag the Dog, Sphere, and Man of the Year.
It's a little up and down.
Tailed off a little bit.
But he's also an Academy Award winner. Best Director, Rain Man, 1989. He's nominated three times for writing, Justice for All, Diner, and Avalon. He was also nominated for Best Director and Best Picture for Bugsy. Quite acclaimed.
And then Steve Adams. Not that Steve Adams. Wrote Envy. He also wrote 19 episodes of Donnie and Marie, 11 episodes of Fridays, and then two movies called Waiting Forever and No Stranger Than Love.
Bunch of bullshit, honestly. Envy is also executive produced by Larry David, which is the only real movie that he's produced.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that.
Well, no. What about
Clear History is an HBO movie that he stars in. But this is like the only movie that he produced that he wasn't in.
He wasn't a producer on Clear History?
Yes, he produced Clear History, but he also starred in it.
Oh, so this is the only movie he produced, but he didn't star in it, is what you're saying.
And it's also an HBO movie, so it's not like released in theaters.
Well, fuck you, snob.
Fuck me? I'm pointing out a trivia fact.
That's not trivia. Like, oh, it's an HBO movie. That ain't shit. Larry David, your career is shit.
Who's on first? Yeah.
If I asked you 3 minutes ago, what is the only movie that was released in theaters that Larry David produced, you wouldn't have guessed this.
Yes, I would have.
Synopsis for Envy. A man becomes increasingly jealous of his friend's newfound success. That's what Envy means, so that makes sense. Tagline. It's for the neighbor with everything. Alternate tagline. Success didn't go to his head. It went to his neighbor.
Uh-huh. I like that. Witty.
It's pretty good, actually.
Yeah, it's not bad. $40 million estimated budget, grossed $13.5 million U.S. and $14.4 million worldwide. It was a bust.
Floppity flop.
I blame the marketing.
This should not have been a hard one to sell, although we'll get into the reviews. Before we jump in this movie and you listen to the rest of this podcast, Envy is available on Cinemax. Envy receives 8% from critics on 118 reviews on Rotten Tomatoes. Just 27% from the audience on over 50,000 ratings. Amin, would you like the positive or the negative reviews?
I want to find out who my brethren are who have great taste in movies. Give me the positives.
Well, everybody's just thinking about the negative. Well, I think the glass is half full. Everybody thinks it's half empty.
Kevin Carr of Fat Guys at the Movies.
I knew I'd find an ally in you, Kevin.
Although the plot is thin, there are elements that are funny.
Is he allowed to make fat jokes?
I don't know. Yeah, I don't.
You know what's not thin? You, Kevin Carr.
Jesus.
No, why'd he call the plot thin? I thought the plot was great.
David Nusser of Real Film Reviews. certainly not the flat-out disaster it's been made out to be.
Thank you.
High praise.
Rick Kisonak of Film Threat.
Yes, you like when I kiss her neck.
Attention. It is, in fact, consistently adequate and in places achieves nothing short of above averageness.
What?
Rick Kisonak of MovieWeb.
No!
I kiss her neck too.
Black and Stiller have an appealing chemistry.
Attention.
Mark Baser of Boston Phoenix.
Oh, the Bays.
Pick a city.
I took a pill in the Baser.
This quirky modern day fable from Barry Levinson is the kind of movie you appreciate more than enjoy.
Yeah, there you go. What? Wait, what?
I love that. What do you think it means by that? Walter Cha of Film Freak Central.
Cha.
It's a little like Slugs starring in a movie about salt. I don't get that. Betty Jo Tucker of Real Talk Movie Reviews.
Betty Jo.
That's all you had for?
Yeah.
Envy may not be a likable or entirely amusing flick, but it's an intriguing dark comedy with an important lesson about the green-eyed monster within us all.
No, these are not positive reviews. Fuck y'all, man.
Eugene Novikov of Film Blather. I choose to see Envy's nice, nonsensical weirdness as wit rather than ineptitude, and will continue to do so until Levinson comes to my house and calls himself an idiot.
Okay, that's not a positive.
And then two user reviews. Jeremy W., 5 out of 5 stars. You need to go into this movie with the right mindset. I don't think this movie was meant to win any awards, but its deadpan humor and the brilliantly performed weirdness of Christopher Walken make this movie 5 stars for me. I laugh so hard at the ridiculousness of this movie every time I watch it, and this is what a comedy is all about to me. If you don't get it, that's fine, but this movie shouldn't be looked at with a critical lens.
He said that on an aggregation site for critical lenses.
And then... User Shauna L, 5 out of 5 stars.
Okay, Shauna.
I just can't explain it. This movie makes me laugh. There's probably something wrong with my brain. If you enjoy a great yet awful film, this one's for you.
Why? What? What is going on?
Negative reviews.
At this point of time, my thought on critics not liking stuff is, then turn it off, you fucking weirdo. You have so many options. People who watch an entire project to hate on it, man, it is so weird to me.
Richard Propes of theindependentcritic.com. A talented cast is completely wasted. Nick Rogers of the Film Yap. Charlie Kaufman possibly could have uncovered this story's true smugness. Instead, Jack Black and Ben Stiller exaggerate what works about their styles to the point of annoyance in a can't-miss misfire akin to John Belushi and Dan Aykroyd's Neighbors.
Ah, quit your yapping.
Felix Vasquez Jr. of Cinema Crazed.
If he licks this, then I will lick anything.
Here's my pitch for a product. A spray that causes really bad movies to vaporize into air. Anthony Bresnikan of Associated Press.
If Anthony Bresnikan, no one can. What?
Envy crawls to its finish through a minefield of poor taste and comedic misfires.
It does crawl to the end.
It does not crawl. You're crawling.
Stella Papa Michael of BBC.com.
Oh, Papa Michael right in his face.
What?
Stop!
The differing styles of the two comedians never meld, but the script is so flabby, even an industrial crane couldn't lift it.
Stop it.
What about a monster truck?
Kamal the Diva Lanswell.
Okay, I already hate your review.
Of Three Black Chicks Review.
Kamal is not a black chick. Sorry.
You almost froze him in his tracks there.
I don't envy anyone who has to answer for this bomb.
Aha!
Ya boy, Brian Orndorff of FilmJerk.com.
Been a while, Brian.
He's back. The most disappointing release of the year so far.
Clearly, he didn't know Amin in 2004.
Thomas DeLappa of Boulder Weekly.
DeLappa the good.
When it comes to overexposure, Stiller ranks up there with Janet Jackson's right breast. Topical.
Topical.
Was that really 2004?
It was 2004.
Man, I feel like it was like so much later. James Vernier of Boston Herald. May be the first film in history to feature a computer-generated turd. Bada bing.
Is it?
I don't understand the bada bing.
Also, don't think it's CGI turd.
Isn't it?
Welcome to Cinephobe.
Richard Roper of Ebert and Roper. One of the worst comedies I've ever seen.
Oh, you know who you are? I look at you as just a replacement.
Wow.
Wow.
You're no Gene Siskel. You'll never be.
And then Ken Fox of TV Guide. It's not even a comedy, just an idea for one.
Ooh,
go Fox yourself.
That's a good review there.
Amin, what's your first note?
Nothing says early 2000s like an AOL Time Warner company.
That's true. My first note. Can you guys play a ukulele?
I can't play any instrument.
No.
I've always thought it would be easier to play one for some reason, even though it's still the same concept, right?
This is the thing. I don't know how to play any string instruments because they require me to hold it on one end and hold it on the other end. Like, no. Let me just pluck the chords that I need to pluck. I don't know what to do with my fingers up here. That just seems very confusing.
I bet you don't.
Yeah, not up here.
There's weird down scrolling of the opening credits, which I did not like. Looked like a PowerPoint presentation.
Yeah, and it's supposed to match up with them rotating around them in bed.
Yeah, so there's like a lot of like top to bottom rotating from one scene to the other, and then there's side to side rotating. But essentially, we get Ben Stiller asleep with Rachel Weisz, and he's wearing a mouth guard. We get Jack Black asleep with Amy Poehler, no mouth guard.
Oh, you guys didn't like that? You didn't like the flipping of the... Oh, man, I thought it was a cool effect.
It would have been cool like three times, not for 4 minutes.
Pussy.
Montage of they both get up, they both shave, they're both feeding the kids, and I wrote, fuck, this feels like chaos.
Yeah,
just the idea of getting kids ready in the morning.
Domestic bliss.
Oh my yep, god,
that's what it looks like. Yeah. All you guys thinking about having kids, that's what it looks like. There are several moments in this are like, this is parenthood.
They're cleaning up the breakfast as Ben leaves for work, and Jack is in a much better mood than Ben is.
There's also a song called Envy going the entire time. One of the lyrics is, don't complain about what your neighbor's got. Life will turn to diddly squat.
Bars.
They live in a cul-de-sac.
They live across the street from each other. Have you guys had situations like that where you live right next to good friends or people you work with closely?
Thank God, no.
I mean, not even with the Sons when you were like early in that stage?
Nope. If it wasn't someone who literally lived with me, then no, I never lived near anyone. Not near enough where like I could see them leaving for work and stuff like that. I've never known my neighbors, and I like it that way. I don't like to get to know my neighbors.
I don't like knowing my neighbors. I don't need that. I've never really known them in an apartment building I live in. Like, I don't need to know that. Maze?
No, definitely not. Even like growing up, going to high school, I never lived close enough to anybody.
Now, can you guys imagine us living in the same neighborhood
and recording this podcast from separate houses?
Yes.
I would have to be from separate houses because I would kill either one or maybe even both of you guys.
I'd like to see you try, bitch.
Tension?
Special two plums for Juan.
Ben's driving Jack to work. Jack asks about a maple syrup stain on his pants. Then he tastes it off of Ben's pants.
Can you believe that comes from a tree? Don't taste my pants. I can't taste your pants? Ever. Ever?
Then don't spill maple syrup on them.
Banter.
Jack proposes an invention of an ink pad, but instead of ink, it's soaked in maple syrup or peppermint. Any flavor you want. Ben says it's going to get disgusting.
Like a mattress at the dump.
We see that they work in a 3M factory.
Shout out to the product placement 3M.
Yeah, 3M all over this thing.
You don't usually see that, like an actual industrial company doing the product placement.
Are they in Los Angeles in this movie?
They're in the Valley. They mention it.
Does 3M have factories outside of Minneapolis or Minnesota? Is that dumb? Because isn't it based there?
I don't know. I don't know the answer to that question. I kind of took it for granted that
okay.
I suspended my disbelief.
They're looking over his performance chart, and Jack Black is not focused. He's a dreamer. Ben tells him to sit in his chair. There's lumbar support, and it comes with the office and the promotion. We see that Ben's focus is way higher.
What's the best chair you guys have ever sat in?
Ooh, that's a good question.
I know immediately, man. When I worked for the Suns in the conference room where we would do like a lot of our pre-draft meetings and stuff like that, the chairs in there, oh my god, man, there's one that was newer than the other ones. You could feel it when you sat back in there, like, oh, this one's got some pushback to it. The other ones have just been plowed through by god knows how many bodies, just so loose you just lean back and it's only you falling backwards into the sunken place. But this one was nice and tight, just good amount of resistance.
What are we talking about here?
All my chairs. What's the best chair you've ever sat in?
Best chair I've ever sat in was conference room in the Court of Appeals in Sacramento.
Oh, shit. How about that? Oh, government. God.
So fucking comfortable.
Did you complain about my taxes went to this shit? I'd be mad. Because I looked up how much that chair that I sat in the Suns. I was like, I'm going to get one for home. This shit is dope. I'm thinking like, what, 100, 150 bucks? That bitch was like $700. I was like, what?
Woo.
For a chair?
Now, I felt like I wasted enough taxpayer money with my job there that I was probably breaking even.
You want to bring attention to it. Like, yeah, it's all right. It's just a chair. Mace, what's the most comfortable chair you ever sat in, or the best chair?
My old boss had a comically expensive chair, probably over $1,000, that he had in his office. It wasn't set up for me, and I didn't get to sit in it that often, but it was definitely just the most impressive piece of chair machinery I've ever seen.
Yeah, because I would imagine compared to those like little chairs in the kindergarten class, way more comfortable, right?
We got to definitely write a song about how we do not diddle kids. Do not diddle kids. It's no good diddling kids.
There is no quicker way for people to think that you are diddling kids than by writing a song about it.
You got to write a song. It's just a, ooh, I wouldn't do it with anybody younger than my daughter. No, little kids got to be big. Older than my wife, younger than my daughter, something like that.
The addition of I would imagine is really important here, because without it, it would imply that Zach too likes to sample and partake.
All right. If Jack focuses, he can get a piano-shaped pool and an office.
Expensive.
You get promoted to sandpaper with me and then the world opens up. I laughed at that. Because he genuinely sounded excited about being promoted to sandpaper.
Jack falls asleep in the chair as Ben is explaining more focus. Just needs to get that chart to orange. Not yellow, just orange. Jack is talking about how his hand is an ugly sidekick.
Yeah.
A separate entity altogether.
He's right. Look at your hand. It's so, if you just watch your hand, well, like during the day while you're doing stuff, just watch it. It's so weird looking.
Jack has to be on edibles.
Oh, man.
To be staring at his hand like this.
They see a dog shitting and the owner picking it up. They both say ew. And then Jack has an idea.
I said ew as well. You guys actually sit around fucking picking up shit with your hands. I don't care. There's a plastic bag on it. That's how you spend your days every day? Willingly?
I mean, what do you mean spend my days?
It's not like today he didn't shit, so I didn't have to pick up his shit. You do it every fucking day. Pretty sure he doesn't shit once a day. He's not me.
The alternative is that there's shit everywhere in the neighborhood.
No, the alternative is that I don't have a dog.
Right.
And I don't have to pick up any shit. That's the alternative.
Didn't you have to wipe your kid's ass at some point? Same thing.
And then it stopped. Like 3 years in.
Yeah, I mean, he'll die at some point and it stops.
All right, I mean, shit. All right. If you're cool like that, I'm cool too. Are you going to get another dog when your dog dies?
Probably not. Not for a while, at least. I'm not going to need to like replace that.
Why? Because it's too sad? Like, oh, do you want to like being divorced? You want to enjoy like, oh, fuck, I'm not jumping right back into a relationship. I'm going to get as much pussy as I want.
Yeah, Zach just wants to go hang out with random single dogs.
Yeah, I just want to fuck single dogs. No, it's probably both.
I would ask Mays, but I'm still traumatized. I recorded a podcast earlier where Mays was the producer. And we did it on Zoom, so everyone's camera was on. And Mays just... fucking sat there. I swear to God, I couldn't make eye contact because every time I looked at his screen, I would just start fucking dying laughing while our guest was like talking about some serious shit that was not like funny. So I had to look around and do whatever I could to distract myself. Mace just has cats just chilling and like they don't move or anything. They just sit there like, yeah, that's right. We're going to podcast. I don't know why this idea came to me, but I said, oh, I know what I'll do to alleviate my laughter. I'll text Zach. I said, Mays is producing and his camera's on and I'm fighting the urge to laugh. And Zach's answer is, can you see kids in the background?
I thought that was funny.
It was funny, but that's not what I was looking for at the time.
All right. Jack has an idea, guys.
Yes.
Spray can. Sprayed it on the dog poop and it disappears. Cut to Rachel and Ben lying in bed at night, and she says if they had extra money, she'd get liposuction.
Future callback.
Phone rings, and it's Jack.
Timmy, check this out.
What?
You know that invention of mine that makes turds disappear?
Ugh.
I got a name for it. Va-Pod-Rize. It's just like vaporize, only you add an O, so you got poo right there in the middle.
Yeah, I get it.
Do you see how perfect it is? Maybe you even underline the poo. Va-Pod-Rize.
I hate when people do that about stuff that hasn't happened.
Yeah.
You know my movie idea? Like, no.
You know that movie I did?
You know my big Vegas trip, right? Like, you haven't even bought a ticket. What are you talking about? My big Vegas trip. You're not doing shit. Punk bitch.
Ben isn't into it, but Jack is obsessed. Cut to the T-ball game. And Jack's kid strikes out, kicks the ball off the tee, and then breaks the fucking tee in half and throws it.
Oh.
I was dying because this kid takes a part of it and chucks it at the backstop. Like, he's so mad that he struck out playing t-ball.
I mean, I would be too.
I loved it.
I love that Jack Black is very supportive throughout that. And I also love the kid does it with like a quiet, calm rage, right?
Yes.
He's not screaming or crying. He's just kind of like matter-of-factly going through this rage.
Jack mentions that Dimitrioff, in research, is into Va-Pod-Rize. Ben keeps shitting on the idea. Jack thinks he's onto something.
Va-Pod-Rize!
Both families in this net tent with the kids playing harmonica.
And the other kid is banging a trash can lid with the doll.
Yeah.
I said, this is what parenthood looks like.
Oh my God.
Right there. That's what it looks like.
No, I can't. I don't think I can do it. Because it's every day, right? Like, you don't get to, like, not be parents to your kids some days.
They're never cool. Like, are you asking me, like, are they cool some days? No, they're not.
No, I mean, like, some days they're just gone.
Oh.
Like, for a full couple of days, and, like, I don't have to deal with it.
I'm in Miami, so, like, that's my answer to that. Oh, I gotta leave for work again, kids. Ooh, all week.
Jack is talking about how he's been at Dimitrioff's place lately. They're having a ball with this experiment. And that's when we find out Ben didn't tell Rachel about the invention. And she thinks it's awesome.
She loves it.
Ben says it's not an invention.
Things don't just disappear.
Rachel thinks it's a great idea.
How does it work? We spray on it and the poo disappears.
Honey, I have an invention. Uh-huh. It's this button that you press and then wings spread out of your back and you can fly.
All right.
You can fly into outer space. You can fly to the moon. You can fly to Jupiter if you like.
Rachel says, how does anything work? How does electricity work? And all I could think of was the insane clown posse.
Water, fire, air, and dirt. Fucking magnets. How do they work? And I don't want to talk to a scientist. Y'all motherfuckers lying and getting me pissed.
Now we cut to a school play and Ben's kid is playing a tree. Rachel says he's doing so well. Ben says he's not doing anything.
3 months of rehearsal so his kid can be a silent tree.
Dimitrioff wants to take the invention to the next level. It's $4,000. Jack asks Ben if he wants to go in on it with him. Ben says, I pray to God you're kidding. Rachel wants to invest the $2,000. Says, shit just doesn't disappear. It has to go somewhere.
Future callback.
Whispering loudly and aggressively the whole time. It's a pie in the sky idea.
Ben says he should pull out. As his best friend, he should pull out.
Baby.
That's what she said.
Ben and Rachel are woken up in the middle of the night. Jack is testing something outside. They get a dog to poop. There's poop on the ground and Dimitrioff is there. Poop gets sprayed and it disappears and Rachel is just glaring Ben as everybody else is celebrating.
The look is so good.
Anyone who's been in a relationship knows that look. That is a dangerous look.
It's a dangerous look.
Jack Black yells out, spray some on my butt because I just shit myself.
Amy Poehler just keeps yelling they're going to be so rich.
Popping bottles.
Cut to 18 months later. Jack is wearing like a plastic tablecloth for his shirt on a home shopping network setup. And the graphic says 1.5 billion in sales, millions of satisfied customers, sold in stores everywhere in 1995. He is the ultimate infomercial or home shopping network person.
He hits it on the nose.
No matter what kind of dog you have, let's face it, they all have to do their business. That's right! One spray, problem solved. Is this some kind of video trick?
No!
It's the miracle spray. One spray and doggy dude disappears. No fuss, no muss, no tools to clean, no robot arms. How do you work it? I don't know. Too good to be true?
No!
Va-Pod-Rize, because life is tough enough.
Available at stores everywhere.
It's perfect. That's exactly how they are.
It's fantastic. Now they're in a mansion.
But they stayed in the cul-de-sac.
Jack's kid is a world-class pianist, and Ben's kid is still banging a trash can with a doll.
Ben is wincing at every trash can crash.
With every hit, like bang, bang, he's just fucking wincing. It's so perfect.
Jack Black's wardrobe in this is incredible. Amy Poehler is decked out in gold, and she's decided to run for Congress.
Not the big Congress, of course, the little one.
The little Congress. By the way, I looked at this, I was like, this is what Donald Trump's home life looks like. We are so lucky, and we have so much. She hits the so's every fucking time. I think there's a quick cut of like Rachel just looking at Ben like, motherfucker.
Actually, I don't even know if it's the Congress. It might be the state Senate. I can't remember.
Main platform is the environment.
Like the whole environment?
The whole environment?
I believe in all environments, and I'm going to say it.
And then we have flan for dessert.
No wonder Amin loves this movie so much.
By note, Amin, file.
The flan. Oh, boy.
Woo!
Come on, kids. Flan time. Flan,
here you guys. Get down here. The flan's here. Flan, kids. Flan.
I love flan. Do you love flan? What is flan?
God,
you are in for such a treat.
You don't know flan?
Eat your flan, buddy.
Yeah, it's flan.
Guys, flan to the table.
Flan.
Just so uncouth and unsophisticated.
Ben's family doesn't know what flan is. Cut to Ben is reading his kid a bedtime story, and all the kid can focus on is the flan.
Boy, that flan was good. I wish we had flan.
Yes, Ben, well, they're getting the itty bitty pool. It's not the itty bitty pool, that's the square model. They're getting the bean shaped pool.
A little itty bitty bean.
It's not a little itty bitty bean, it's an average size bean, Mikey. And I got news for you, my friend. There are kids in parts of the world who would walk 50 miles through quicksand just so they could stick a toe in your swimming pool. And I got news for you about beans, too, mister. There are kids who would eat beans because they've had nothing to eat their whole life but leaves and bark and roots. And I guarantee you, none of them has ever heard of your big show-off flan or flan or whatever you want to call it that you got to have every night of the week. Okay?
At the end, Rachel says $2,000. That's all it would have taken.
Oh my God. He's going to do that for the rest of his life.
Question. If this was your best friend, after the product looks like it's successful, would you let them in on it before it really blew up?
Spoiler alert, like he did?
No, I'm saying before this point.
Oh.
I would say like, come on, let's get in on this.
Like he did. The investment's been made and now the thing blew up and now I got to go back. Like for instance, if like Count the Dings blows up, right?
Right.
Would we go back to Ethan and be like, yo, Ethan, are you sure you don't want to be part of this?
Yeah, we don't like Ethan.
No, I mean, I'm just trying to pick someone that we've podcasted yeah. with a lot that's not part of this.
Right.
No. I'm like, hell no. Here's the weird part, Zach. I thought about the same question, but a different angle. The angle I thought of is, who would be the friend who would like cut me in on this after the fact?
Oh, that's a good question. One. Yeah. Did you come up with an answer?
I did, but I want to hear what your answer is.
I think because he's such a generous guy, I think Ian Carmel would cut like the whole crew in on a big business or something.
Jiro, out of your mind. He wouldn't do that.
Nah, man. He's a generous dude.
I mean, generous is one thing. Giving you a cut of a billion plus dollar business is something else, man.
You'd obviously have to do stuff for it.
I mean, then again, no, because it's not like Ben Stiller did anything but hate on this dude his whole time.
Spoiler alert.
Well, if I'm Jack Black, I would have offered Ben Stiller a job sooner than 18 months in.
Give him a job. I would make him my partner in this shit. If I'm banking a billion, I'll get you assholes jobs. I mean, they'd be shitty ass jobs, though. Like, I'd make sure.
Yeah, we don't have to do anything. Right?
I would get him a good job.
When I was with the Sun towards the end, when I was working with complete fucking assholes, right? One of the things I used to fantasize about was that they would figure out these people were assholes. This is how weird my fantasies work. I didn't even fantasize that I would get promoted. I fantasized that someone else would come in and know what they're doing. And so I would advise them, I'm like, don't fire them. Because that's what they do. They fire these people and they pay them out and they get to sit at home. I'm like, no. You don't fire them. You put that motherfucker on the G League circuit. Send them to Dakota, send them to Sioux Falls, send them to all the shitty places, and I want reports.
Oh, so you Milton them.
Hi, Milton. What's happening?
Milton, we're going to need to go ahead and move you downstairs into storage B.
No,
we have some new people coming in, and we need all the space we can get.
But there's no space.
So if you could just go ahead and pack up your stuff... and move it down there, that would be terrific.
I reports every fucking week on my desk. And then we're going to read it, and we're going to read it in front of everybody and laugh. I wanted to do that. I had this whole plan. And then it didn't work out because they didn't hire anyone. They just fucking kept on with this complete asshole who didn't know shit.
Cut to breakfast the next morning. Ben's doing the insecure. What? Where he thinks that they've said something, but clearly they haven't. And Rachel calls him out on it. Kid agrees. And then Corky, Jack's horse, comes over to their side. And the kids want to go pet him. That's what Rachel says. Corky happens to be a sweet and gentle horse, and me and the kids love him. And Ben says, Corky happens to shit the size of a bread basket in our yard every day when he comes to visit. Rachel pulls out the Va-Pod-Rize and puts it right next to Ben on the table. Mic drop. Then Ben throws it in the garbage.
Filmmakers love the garbage can shot. And what I mean by that, they put the camera at the bottom of the garbage can. It's got to be one with a lid so that you see the lid open and you see the face of the actor as he throws some in. And I wondered who was the first to say, go put the camera in the trash can.
Gotta be Hitchcock, right? They have trash cans back then? Probably not.
Not with lids. The shit was just like an open bucket.
Yeah, has that been around before the refrigerator shot?
Ooh, refrigerator shots. We talked about that in Action Jackson, right?
Yeah.
Oh, wow, that's a good one. Oh, which came first, the trash can or the fridge shot? I'm going to say fridge. I don't know why.
I'm going to say trash can.
Mays, you're the tiebreaker.
Definitely the inside the anaconda throat shot was first.
You guys like sex, right? Of course you do. If you like sex, you'll love BlueChew.com. It offers men a performance enhancement for the bedroom. You can get the first chewables with active ingredients, sildenafil and tadalafil. I think I said those correctly, but you know, those are the active ingredients in Viagra and Cialis. BlueChew.com affiliated physicians will work with you, find the dosage and active ingredient that is best for you. It works faster. The chewables work faster. Chewables from Blue Chew can be taken on a full or empty stomach, so you don't have to plan out whether or not you're like, oh, I gotta make sure I gotta eat an hour before this. No, forget all that. Pop that chewable and then pop something else. Online physicians consult is free, so it's even cheaper than those other two things you can get. It only takes a few minutes to connect with BlueChew.com affiliated physician. And if you qualify, you get prescribed online quickly. No in-person doctor visit, no awkward conversation, no waiting in line at a pharmacy. Ships directly to your door in a discreet package. The chewables from BlueChew, they're made in the USA. They give you confidence in the bed every time. You and your partner, more importantly, will love it. Chew it and do it. Here's a great deal for you guys. Visit BlueChew.com. Get your first order free when you use the promo code DING. Just pay $5 shipping. That's BlueChew.com. Promo code DING.
The package delivered is discreet. The package you'll deliver isn't.
That's what I love this. Rachel Weisz gets on the chair. She unscrews the light bulb and she says she's throwing away some other completely useless invention.
Light? Light? Come on. Come on. This was shit. You think Edison would have even looked up from his workbench at some shit spray? Good invention is a good invention.
I got news for you, sister. Edison ain't looking up.
Sister?
Sister?
I'm calling you sister.
You should be so lucky to be my sister. Oh. Yeah, my sister knows what she's talking about.
Wind talker, whatever hell her name
is. Do not call her that. She's called Windsong. Windsong.
Windsong. My mistake. Windsong.
Jack walks in looking like Fat Albert on Easter.
Knockety knockety. A knock knock knock. He is dancing his ass off.
Corky walks up to the half door like it's Mr. Ed. Jack goes over and pets him, asks if Corky has become a nuisance. He keeps eating their apples. He loves their apples.
He also gestures at an insanely expensive coffee maker he got them.
There is a massive cappuccino machine on the counter that is so fucking funny to me, because all I can think about is that thing is there every single day in that small ass kitchen just taking up an entire counter.
That's the hilarious thing about this movie, is that there are all these signs of opulent wealth. It's in the middle of this middle class community where, like, it's clearly is not even like capable of handling all this shit. When they walk outside and we see the full scope of this mansion that is literally built on the plot across the street where Jack Black's original house was.
Right.
This dude built this obnoxious monstrosity of a campus right across the street from Ben Stiller.
There's a weird CGI zoom out of the huge mansion, and it looks like The Sims.
We built this city. We built this city on CGI. Sim City.
And this is how I know it was in L.A. It's like, when we hit it big, we could have gone to Malibu or Beverly Hills. People told us we should go there. But I was like, why would I move away from my best friend? I'm going to stay right here in the valley.
They're going to play golf. Jack has a gift for Ben before they get into his yellow Lambo, and it's a blue version of what Jack is wearing. That's when we get the golf cart exposition with Jack explaining why he built the house.
It looks like a Coogi sweater, basically. A short sleeve, if it's a polo.
Ben's blue pants are like metallic looking.
Yeah, a little shiny, yeah.
They are awful golfers, and they've got two caddies with them that is costing a fortune, but money is nothing to Jack now. kids are going to Aunt Winsong's. Ben has to stick around for work.
You're going to have a great time at Aunt Nancy's. Aunt Winsong.
It's Aunt Winsong now.
Winsong, and you know that.
This is like how my aunt changed her name to Sedona, and I'm still confused about what to call her. My mom calls her Marie, and so do I, but she definitely would like to be called Sedona.
I don't like that. I don't think you just change your name like that and get people already in your life to call you that.
What if you change your email address? You have to call them that.
Zachary.
You cannot change your email address.
I've done it. It's the worst. Ugh,
it's awful.
It's the worst.
You can't do it.
I wish I kept my old email address.
What was it?
Fatballs@hotmail.com. It's PHATBALLLL. Z.
It was clubberlang@gmail.com. It was so fucking perfect.
Ah.
But then I was like, I started to get like self-conscious. I was like, yo, is this good? Does this look unprofessional?
Yes.
Yeah.
Rachel says she can't look at Ben anymore. She can't look across the street. She's run out of places to look. Jack and his kid are practicing archery. Amy's painting their daughter with a horse. And Ben goes to work. Cut to him eating TV dinners in the net tent.
That is a pathetic looking TV dinner. The Envy song comes back.
It's tough to look across the fence. Dollars when you can't make sense. Bound to make a man feel tense. Super dot do dot be Envy.
Jack is riding Corky in a cheetah robe and he salutes yeah. Ben with a classic smug look and goes, yeah!
It's just classic.
And at this point, I noticed that Corky's casa is probably bigger than Ben's entire house.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. It's absolutely, absolutely bigger.
It is.
At work, Ben is being asked if he's distracted. His focus chart has nosedived into the red.
You seem distracted!
Now, is there anything that happened around here you might like to talk about?
No.
You sure?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no.
Any reason?
Reason, no. Can't think of no.
Any reason at all?
No. No reason, no. I mean, nothing I can think of. I mean, you know, other than every day I get into my little shitbox car and there he is with the wind in his hair on his great big shiny horse. And I drive off to do what? To make sandpaper. To make paper with sand on it. I would love to see you try to turn your weaselly little mouth into a fake smile day after day after day while you have to wave tootily fucking do to your best friend who's rearing up on a big white horse like he's the Lone Ranger. Then I'd like to take a peek at your performance chart, you beady-eyed little shrimp boat bastard! Is that a reason? I mean, is that a reason?
Acting his ass off.
Acting his ass off indeed.
The little shitbox car? My brother had that same fucking Corolla, man. I learned to drive on that Corolla.
Cut to Ben goes to a bar. He doesn't really drink, but his family left him and he got fired. So give him whatever you think you would want him to drink.
Exposition's his life story to the bartender.
Got yourself in trouble today. Zeep bop doo ba dee da day. It's gonna be hell to pay. Envy.
Harsh. Abandoned. Fired.
Walking.
Acting his ass off.
Is acting his ass off. Says the best job he ever got fired from is a pretzel kiosk.
Oh, come on, Herc. Head first.
Oh, come on, Herc.
And the way he says pretzel kiosk fucking threw me.
The way he says everything.
Pretzel kiosk. Afternoon shift, just loved it. Don't know why, just did. Could be the apron, who the hell knows, or maybe the feeling of power you get when there's a crowd, you know, and one hand's rolling the dough, tying those babies off, the other hand's maybe working the soda, refilling the mustard. It's quite a thing, quite a thing. But I'll tell you a little secret. If a pretzel is a quality pretzel, you don't need salt. It's just a fact.
I fully agree with this. A good pretzel does not need salt.
It needs salt. It's just a fact.
I don't think it needs anything, really. I do like a mustard with it, but it doesn't need anything if it's a good pretzel.
No, a good pretzel is just like, give me the pretzel and then I eat it, right? Like, you're talking about like from Auntie Anne's, right? We're not talking about pretzels out of a bag.
No. I'm talking about like the big ass fucking carnival pretzel or whatever.
Walk-in looks like he's wearing two different carpets for clothes.
Bartender brings a drink that's inside of a pineapple. Walken asks why his family left. Thank you, but I don't really feel like talking about it. Okay, how come you got canned?
It's a whole different topic.
Well played.
This line will be with me forever.
Good for you, man. Good for you. Good for you.
First thing I think of when I think of this movie.
I blew up at my boss. Right on, brother. I hear you. I wrote, you're my brother. Walken introduced himself as J-Man. Now he orders another round.
On the J-Man.
Let it tumble out like little circus freaks. J-Man is zeroed in. And as Ben's talking, I don't know anything that Ben said because I'm just focused on Walken hype manning this. Keep it coming. Keep it coming. Open your heart. Open your heart. He just keeps saying all these little things. Fucking great.
Shit. It's all from shit.
You know who you are. You're like that guy. Jay something.
Jay something?
Up with the people. People power. Or that kid that stole a chicken with the golden eggs. What a fantastic chicken. Who's for the giant? Nobody. You hear what I'm saying? You're the hero. Forget Jay. You're like Robin Hood.
Walken tells a story about stealing this kid's BB gun.
Ernie. Ernie, nice kid.
Shot it into his house. His dad got pissed and things changed big time over there in Ernieville.
You school
off to your house? Ben is drunk as shit. Three pineapples deep.
The best part of this conversation is it ends with Ben saying, oh shit, what time is it? And Walken says, what kind of question is that?
Ike, cab on the J-Man.
Ben gets back there. Jack has go-kart racing at his place. The pool is half dug. Ben says they don't have the money for it now. And then Jack's butler brings over a bottle of wine to him. Says he looks wonderful.
Really, really wonderful. And Eduardo is acting his ass on.
Oh, on?
Oh, on?
No. No.
I love Eduardo.
Wine is from their newly acquired vineyard. Cut to Ben is drunk at night walking around the lawn. He likes the hedge work. He's drunk on the carousel. He's spinning in the archery area. And then he grabs a bow and arrow, fires the arrow. We hear the horse make a noise, and he collapses.
How could a little arrow kill a big horse?
He tries to give a horse CPR, by the way.
Mm-hmm. He tries to revive it. He tries to push it into the pool hole. He tries to use the little mini monster truck to push it in. Then he greases up the area in front of it, rams the horse. Cut to, he finally got it in. He buried the horse in the hole. All the dirt is patted down the next morning.
He looked CGI'd into the monster truck. I watched that scene about three times today. I was like, that doesn't look like him in the car. It looks like they digitally imposed his upper body into the driver's seat.
Collapses into bed early in the morning, and then the J-Man wakes him up.
Cock-a-doodle-doo. Car return. How's that for service? I'd probably still be driving a limo if it weren't for the hat. Hats make my head itch.
He looks at Jack's house across the street, says, I don't even live here, and it's literally pulling my testicles up. You ever get that?
Ben also asks what time it is again, and he says, man, you got a time hang up, don't you?
Ben admits that he killed the horse, then sees his family's home, tells Walken to hide. He says, hide? I can't just mosey off.
I'm the J-Man.
Rachel and the kids are so excited to see him. Windsong changed her view on everything that's going on. They need to focus on what they have, not what they don't have.
What's at the heart of the heart of the heart of the heart? Self-love.
And then Walken walks out of the bathroom and scares the shit out of Rachel.
Cue Ben Stiller lying.
He can't come up with a lie.
But it's still hilarious.
Oh, hey! This guy! Honey, this man is the man who's in the bathroom. I didn't tell you. Honey, something happened while you were gone. Something really bad.
What?
Then the J-Man says, we'll take it from there.
Elmo Karp. Pool rep. Elmo actually does an amazing job covering for Ben here.
He does. Discussing swimming pool options. Dug it and had to fill it back in. Where do we go from here? There's underground pipes in the yard keeping them from getting a pool.
Too many gosh darn pipes.
We find out Jack can't find Corky and the kids are a mess. Amy's canvassing the neighborhood, running for state senate, and people want to know where the turds go.
When Jack Black runs, by the way, he zigzags and he kicks his legs back.
That's his signature run, is the leg kickback. He's been doing it for fucking ever.
Does he do that in other movies?
He's done it in like every movie. Anytime he runs, he does that.
He's just prancing about. He does that as Tenacious D.
Yeah.
Your husband's got the back of a coal miner. I know, because I've mined coal.
I think I'm getting the black lung, Bob.
I just like keeping track of J-Man's careers. Quite a resume.
Ben can't sleep at night. Envy keeps playing.
A man who has to falsify can't look the truth right in the eye. His call for help is a pathetic cry. His deck's a few cards shy. Envy.
He's going to go to work the next day, but he has nowhere to go. Jack stops him. Can't find Corky. He's breaking down. He wants him to pass out flyers at 3M.
He's crying.
A $50,000 reward.
It's pennies! Pennies! Who cares?
He'd pay $50K to find Ben if he was lost, and Jack Black is acting his ass off.
Shoulda took the high road when you had the chance. Now you're on the low road. Just shitting in your pants. Don't live a life of lies and fear. Don't dodge the truth behind the tears. Wind up crying in your beer.
Ben is sitting on the bench passing time, pretending to be at work. J-Man tells Ben they need to move the horse, find him, and get the reward. Dig him up and haul him off. Tells him to take his family to a cabin on the lake.
You think I didn't have a childhood? Bunk beds, hiking trails, hootie owls.
Ben gets his lion times back.
Oh, Jack-O-Meyer.
That worked. Offered up the cabin. It's an hour away. What I love about this, so in all other movies, when Ben starts lying, you know, he just gets away with it. No one really asks questions. In this one,
yes.
Rachel Weisz wants fucking answers.
Oh, she's pressing him.
We're getting where did the shit go protests in front of Amy's campaign headquarters.
We want to know.
Jack's Lambo has the license plate Kaka King. Ben and his family are in the middle of nowhere. The end of a private driveway.
Jack-O-Meyer is a great name, by the way.
Jack-O-Meyer is a great name. They're in the wilderness with all their luggage, and that's when Ben Stiller falls down an incline to a shithole cabin. Whoa. Kids want to know where the lake is.
This is wild, huh, kids?
Let's check out the bunkhouse, and then you kids can have a contest, see who can find the lake first. Winner gets 50 cents.
His fake enthusiasm is fucking top-notch.
It's great.
They find what the lake is supposed to be. I can't even call it a pond. It is a puddle. A sewage.
But he says his line. Maybe there's a tide.
There's a tide.
It's nighttime and someone's walking around the cabin. Knock on the door. Ben goes to answer the door. Some random guy says, Tim, twice. You're Tim. J-Man says, come quick. That's it. When you see the J-Man, tell him Bosco says, we're even. And up your ass with mobile gas.
Up your ass with mobile gas.
Ben then says it's Jack's neighbor and he needs to help.
Neighbor?
Yeah, that's right. Bosco. He's as nice as Jack, but his car is stuck, so I'm going to go help him, okay?
I didn't see any neighbors.
What do you think Bosco would lie? Why would Bosco lie? I'll go get him right now if you want. I'll go get him.
Okay.
Okay?
Yes, yes, I'd like to ask him about this hell.
I don't want to bring him in here. He's big. He might, you know, the floorboards.
How big?
How big?
Yes.
Big. He's like a bear of a guy with like a little head.
Windsong would help this guy. He's flailing.
He gets back home. He can't undo his seatbelt. He's struggling with everything. Walks in his own house as the phone is ringing. J-Man says it's for him and don't ask about the crumbs because he's on the edge of the edge. Jack says Amy stormed out of the bedroom. Horrible fight. Ben needs to come over right now. We go outside. There's a horse suspended in the air with a winch just out in the fucking middle of everything.
Amazing.
J-Man does this little hip shake dance looking at the monster truck. Whoa!
You got the idea from Easter Island.
You're like a specially trained super agent. You know that? Why do you think I called you? I was so pissed off. I nearly climbed back into your house and smashed some plates.
The flatbed he got originally, it shorted out when he hotwired it. But then he says, he got this truck right here. Good thing he passed out or else I never would have got this baby. The way he says baby is fucking amazing. I love it.
Ben says to put the horse on his van. Don't make any noise. He's got to go to Jack. There are maids and butlers bowling in the house to practice for the tournament coming up.
Who's your nanny? The lady yells when she gets a strike.
And Jack is lying in this gigantic Al Jefferson bed.
Oh! Oh my God, bro! I had the same note too! Al Jefferson's 12-foot by 10-foot bed cost him $23,000.
They hear the J-Man with the horse. Ben says it's a bowling practice. And while Jack is talking, Ben just closes the door so they can't hear the J-Man sawing. I'm pretty sure sawing the horse.
Bunch of noises moving the dead horse. How do I know where this shit goes?
Ben tucks him in and then says not to hear things. cut to Ben driving away with the horse on top of his van covered with a tarp.
Valderi! Valdera! Etc.
J-Man wants to drive far away so nobody finds the horse. They stop and get gas. It's pouring rain. The bridge is out.
He drove a yogurt truck for 6 months and this is his territory.
When they get stopped by the cops, the tail is peeking out and getting hit by the wiper blades that he don't notice it. They got to take a detour along the river. They're arguing about where to leave it. They stop and the horse is gone. Fell off somewhere back there.
Who knows knots? Not you. Well, I'm not Popeye. Banter!
Next morning, Ben tries to sneak back into the cabin. He breaks through a floorboard as his wife wakes up. Back home, and Ben is singing as he puts stuff on dirt. Jack calls him over. Butler says he's looking as fit as a fiddle.
Fit as a fiddle.
So he also says Jack is running in the woods, and then we see him on a treadmill surrounded by a curved screen.
You know what that is, guys? The forerunner for Peloton.
Jack says he found out that Ben got canned at 3M.
Buddy boy. That my little hearty hi-ho silver routine each morning had that kind of effect on you. Man, all I can say is I am such a jerk, but it's the best thing that ever happened because now I'm gonna go kick ass in Rome. And guess what? You unemployed bum, you're gonna come kick ass with me because I want us to be partners. I want us to be equal again, man. Why not? I mean, for crying out loud, I've got a Pete. Why shouldn't you have a Pete? Wouldn't you like having a Pete? Of course you would. Who wouldn't? So this is a deal. From now on, you and me, 50-50.
50-50?
That's right, 50-50. I'm gonna talk to my lawyer. You know what? I don't know why I didn't think of this sooner. It's awesome! Now get the hell out of here! The limo leaves in an hour and a half! Buddy boy! Let's go, buddy boy!
Rachel and Ben are talking about being in the shit industry, and she says they should try it. She's excited.
What if it conflicts with the heart of the heart of the heart of the heart?
There's Poozar on the limo plate. They get on the PJ. Ben is with the tailor.
Oh.
Ben has ideas to target zoos because of the elephants.
Yep.
Travel industry. What about little travel size Va-Pod-Rize, like the little shampoo bottles, little Velcro holster on your belt next to your cell phone and their pager. And I wrote 20th century bitch in 2004.
Very 20th century bitch, but you know what? I'm allow it.
Jack creates a jingle for it while they're on the plane.
Accessorize with Va-Pod-Rize.
Hold on. Let me take it from here. You're walking along. Doodly doo.
All of a sudden,
you stepped in poo! You don't know what to do.
What do you do?
I don't know what to do. Va-Pod-Rize, Va-Pod-Rize, mountain-scented Va-Pod-Rize.
And the way Ben chimes in with, what do you do?
It sounded like Jack was coming up with it on the spot and Ben was just trying to like hype man it a little bit.
In real life, right?
Yeah, the Garth and Kat, like on Weekend Update when Fred Armisen and Kristen Wiig would do it.
Yes, that's exactly what it seemed like.
Va-Pod-Rize, Va-Pod-Rize. What's that? Those are the drums.
Now they're in Rome at a luxury hotel. They're Va-Pod-Rizing the pigeon shit on the street. They're Va-Pod-Rizing sheep shit.
This whole Italy sequence is so ridiculous.
They're in Rome, and what's playing is the Italian version of the Four Tops Sugar Pie Honey Bunch.
Banger.
Which is just fucking perfect. And they're walking around like they are the fucking saviors of the world. Dressed in all white suits, Jack's hair is slicked all the way back, and he's holding it up like it came from God. Like he's Moses coming down with the Ten Commandments, holding up the Va-Pod-Rize as it just sprayed over everything.
This is his big Italian opportunity, just to run around in the streets and spray random animal shit for the people. Billions!
Romans are stunned by it. They're all over the news. They're fountain shopping. And then J-Man sees a business news report of it in Rome. Cut to Jack and Ben are in a jacuzzi with, I think, the president?
I just wrote a jovial Italian man who uses a translator to talk about how their penises are similar.
Yeah, he tells them when they got into the tub that he noticed their three penises were similar in size and mold. He thought, good. Envy is a funny, funny thing.
He said it.
He remembers being a teenager in New York one summer with his friend Armando. Armando had a hog like a freight train. Made him miserable. Not all the time, but sometimes.
Freight train hog. Who is this guy? Are we getting a morality lesson?
He's a minister. The translator refers to him as the minister.
Okay, so it's a prime minister.
No, he might be the minister of trade or the minister of interior or whatever.
Oh, okay.
The minister of freight train hogs is what he is.
There's a phone call for Ben. J-Man is pissed.
Turbo everyman, my ass!
Says he bought him drinks, let him vacation at his bungalow. Yeah. Now he jumps ship.
I love how he's fucking...
Screw Robin Hood! Screw the merry men! You're a stinko pinko! burn coat.
He's at the gas station with the attendant for $50K. Lester keeps thinking it's a sofa on top of that car.
Homemade sofa.
And doesn't spill the beans about the horse. Now they're back home. Rachel has been liposucked. She bought a Mercedes SUV. She wants to fuck on the laundry. Kids are at the grandparents' house.
I will lie with you in the laundry. He fucking stutters his way through that. But first, I got to tell you something.
Then he admits to her he killed Corky. Amy starts asking Jack where the shit goes. He says, up. Up and out.
Out where?
Rachel shook. She says, go pay the bum. About the extortion. Go pay the bum. He warns the bum might want more. She says, they'll have enough money. Can't let him tell Jack. Says they could fess up. Ask for forgiveness, and she's freaking out, and she's Jeff Van Gundy in his leg.
Rachel Weisz acting her ass off.
Oh, yeah. And that's when Jack walks in, thinking that he's walked in on them having sex, and he wants what they have.
He's so envious of Ben. Wow!
Wow!
To be fair, her face is firmly planted in Ben Solo's crotch.
All the windows closed. The heat turned up to about 82, so it gets sweaty.
I know that wasn't the intent of their interaction, but for someone walking in, yeah, it looked like she's about to go to town on that hog.
Freight train hog.
Freight train of hog.
No, it's a medium-sized hog because it was just like the minister's.
It's all relative. We don't know. The minister might be hung like a horse for all we know.
Hung like Corky. Amy's locked in a room. The three of them are talking to her outside the door. Rachel says they're going to hold a rally to support her. And she walks out. May I suggest we put on our dancing shoes?
The way Amy Poehler talks in this movie fucking cracks me up. Because she always like feels like she's dropping like the illest bars ever.
It's new money shit right there. Like that's what it is.
Oh yeah, we're going to focus on the environment. She drops that shit so hard. Just like when she comes out like, we put our dancing shoes on. And she's fucking killing it.
J-Man asks Ben on the phone how the flight was. He says they'll pay the money, but he says he can't accept the $50K. What are we, animals?
That is sensational news, my little gypsy roving friend.
They're pals now. He wants to be partners instead, a triumvirate.
You slept in my bunk. I ate some of your crackers. We sang in the rain.
He says they'll iron out the details when he comes over later. This evening. Who the hell knows when?
He keeps talking all throughout.
He never shuts the fuck up. He's always talking.
Well, as Ben Stiller is just like zoning out because he's realizing this shit is crumbling down around him. Christopher Walken is just talking that whole time on the phone.
He says he's coming over. They'll put pen to paper, smooth out the rough parts. The running part of him being overly comfortable with Ben is just great. And that's kind of what you're talking about with him talking all the time. Like he's just like embedded himself with someone who he doesn't really know. And Ben knows that he doesn't really know, but he just thinks he's in.
He's the J-Man.
Cut to the four of them dancing. Ben is super uncomfortable. Rachel's trying to get him to adjust, and Jack and Amy are way too comfortable dancing.
Rachel is so stiff the way she dances, man. I think you use your hips, and like, if she's acting, she just won her acting their ass off award right there.
Yeah, because she mentions it later, like, I figured it out.
No, but we've never seen her dance properly, though. So I think that's just a line, and she really can't dance.
She's moving like Sam Jackson in Great White Hype. Yeah. J-Man comes over. The maid brings the kids to Jack because the merry-go-round is acting up again. Jack and Ben go to deal with it. Ben's trying to confess to him, and Jack keeps interrupting him about the carousel every chance. He's struggling to get to the middle of it. Why do they put the controls at the middle of the carousel? Flies off and crashes to the ground.
Bastard bitch merry-go-round. Stupid merry-go-round.
That's a great line.
Ben says he'll get to the middle to turn it off, and then they'll talk, and then he goes flying into the archery field. And as he's about to confess, the carousel starts shorting out and explodes a little bit. And the explosion makes Jack's ears ring. He can't really hear. Ben keeps trying to confess and Jack interrupts. Might just be the one ear. Nope, it's both ears.
Ben has picked up the bow and arrow in the meantime to try to explain what happened with Corky. And then he shoots it again and hits the J-Man in the back as he's sneaking in the house.
And he's sneaking into the second floor.
He's the J-Man.
He's the J-Man. I love that. His idea of breaking in is I'm going to go through the window on the second floor. All right. Jack has walked back in. Rachel is drunk looking for him. And then Ben says he killed the bum, brings her to see the body, but the body's gone. She says she doesn't get his joke sometimes. Yeah. And she doesn't think it's just her.
That's a good line.
J-Man walks up to a couple making out in a car. They tell him it's an arrow in his back. He says he's being stalked by a dark force.
Genuine madman.
Matterman.
Ben is driving around with Rachel. He stops the car.
That is a callback to a completely different podcast. Oh my God.
One of ours?
No. I don't even know why I'm describing this shit. We taped this Haver show. Our guest is a writer. She wrote The Post. She wrote Long Shot. Like, this is a real fucking Hollywood person, right? Happened to go to high school with Tom, right? I was asking him, like, have you, like, of the stuff that you worked on that didn't work out, like, is there anything that you would go back? And she said, I don't know. Like, there's this television series that I was trying to get done. And it was, like, kind of sort of like Mad Men. It was right after Mad Men ended, and it was like that. And I asked her, Matterman? That's not so funny when you explain it.
No.
And
so Ben's driving around with Rachel, and that's when the J-Man stops the car. They get out and he says, you ever heard for Reach for the Sky?
We were pals. Who shoots a pal in the back with a bow and arrow over a couple of bucks?
Me. I'm an archer and I shoot arrows, and I got more back where they came from, in my quiver.
You gotta listen to me. I just wanted what you wanted, a little taste of the good life, a little taste of honey. Is that so bad, is it? But you win. Man, I fold, I can see it. Greed has hardened your heart, and money's poisoned your soul. I'm out of here! There's nothing as dangerous as large quantities of money. That's why I've always remained an independent contractor, an odd-job man. I want no part of this. I stand before you, begging. Take the arrow out of my back. You will never see me again. Help me, God! Come on!
Ben takes it out and says it's a souvenir. Take it. J-Man runs away. Then Ben can't sleep. He gets out of bed, and Jack is already walking up to his house. He's nervous about the speech at the rally, and that's when Ben says he's so good at it. Never mentioned the infomercials because it was another thing of his that made Ben miserable. It's time to talk, guys. He killed Corky. He explains the whole thing. We get a fast forward of the entire movie, basically.
Yeah.
And then Jack says that sounds like it was an accident. You should have told him. He's so wrapped up in the envy.
He said it.
That's all Jack did was follow his dream. He built the White House across the street.
It's the White House. You built the White House across the street.
They're in the shadows of it every day, 4 p.m. You got to him. You gave them so much. The coffee machine. Rachel loves it, but he's never tried it.
Your kid's playing the concert piano. My kid's banging trash cans. And I don't think that has anything to do with the money. I think that's just his musical ability. But that's a whole nother thing.
He thinks the horse didn't like him. Has nothing to do with what happened with the arrow. Jack Black's face the whole time is just so puzzled and confused. Like he's trying to process everything. It just cracked me up.
Horse sense is a real thing.
Doesn't deserve to be his partner or his friend. Jack says everybody makes mistakes. And he's still his best friend.
Poor Corky. One little target arrow. You wouldn't think that could kill a great big horse. That's what I thought. When I shot the bum, he hardly seemed to notice. Fountain looked a lot better in Rome. C'est la vie, as the Romans say.
That was... And now it's time for a rally. Is that a power plant? Is that where that is?
The mansion, by the way, is not only in the middle of this kind of like middle class neighborhood, but they're like huge power lines right above it.
Everywhere.
And there's always airplanes taking off and landing. Like they're right by the airport.
They cut to that. They show that a few times as if to like add B-roll to the movie.
Jack at the rally is addressing the poo question as Corky the horse floats by on the river. Cut to the autopsy of the horse and shows that it ate a lot of apples.
Yeah.
And vaporized, poisoned the horse.
Yeah.
Combined with the fecal bacteria, it became a lethal poison. A little person?
The accent on this veterinarian is out of control.
Mr. and Mrs. Vanderburg, sorry we had to perform an autopsy, but when any large dead animal comes into proximity with the general public, it must be examined immediately for health reasons.
She says lethal poison. Ben thought she said little person. She says lethal poison.
Little poison.
Little poison.
Little poison.
She's got to report it to the public. And he's like, do you? Every time?
To the EPA.
Vaporize is being taken off the shelves. There's an estate auction of Jack's stuff in his place. They're eating in the tent, and Ben has an idea, a really big idea. He whispers the idea, and Jack says, yes! They say, stop the auction. Cut to an infomercial saying you can't eat flan and drive at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
This woman's got flan all over her outfit, and they've got pocket flan.
J-Man is in the crowd, and he yells, no spoon, no mess.
Flip it, squeeze it, and enjoy. It's flantastic. J-Man asks, what about those who are lactose intolerant? Got a soy-based one, too. roll credits. And as the credits are going, we're getting more of the infomercial.
They're talking about eating flan while running, biking in the Tour de France, skydiving, scuba diving, you off with scuba, skateboarding, race car driving, and fighting a fire. All times when you want flan.
Trivia. Jack Black, Ben Stiller, and DreamWorks' Jeffrey Katzenberg publicly apologized for the film during a press conference for Shark Tale in 2004.
I did not understand this.
I don't get it.
I don't get it either.
The movie had been shot almost 2 years before it was released in theaters. It was in danger of being released straight to video because the audience response was so poor during test screenings. It was only due to the success of School of Rock that it finally got a theatrical release.
I mean, that's not nice. I mean, first of all, this movie's better than School of Rock. Let me just throw that out there.
No.
Ooh. Yeah. Better than School of Rock.
No.
You know what? I might agree with that because I don't like movies with a lot of kids in them.
I'm like Maze. Maze like, no. School of Rock is definitely better. Way better. Kept my attention.
Oh, man. You know what? I do like this movie better than School of Rock.
It's a better movie.
I think I've only seen School of Rock once, too. So maybe I need to watch it again.
Ving Rhames filmed scenes as a gay detective, but he ended up being cut from the final product.
Does that make him a repeat offender?
Ooh, is there?
Because he was in Kiss of Death.
Can I find the Ving Rhames deleted scenes?
I hope it's a Ving Rhames J-Man scene.
Oh, God.
Ben Stiller was nominated for a Razzie for Worst Actor, but lost to George Bush for Fahrenheit 9/11? What?
Jesus.
That's when the Razzies try to, like, be fucking political. Stick to sports.
The scenes featured in the film where Jack Black and Ben Stiller are in Rome were actually shot in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, due to the fact the film was already over budget and shooting in Italy would have been significantly more expensive. Why not just cut it?
Really?
Why not cut that whole sequence?
Did you just say Rio de Janeiro?
He did say Janeiro, yeah.
I don't like that.
I don't like it, and neither do the Brazilians.
Because you don't say Barcelona.
No, also, it's not Rio de Janeiro. It's de Janeiro. The Brazilian way, the Portuguese way is Janeiro.
Portuguese, bitch.
Yeah, I can learn it.
Sorry, chefe.
Yeah. Where was that from? It's Anaconda, right? Oh, shit, man. We just did that one, too.
Writer Steve Adams is the nephew of novelist Kurt Vonnegut. Bosco's line, up your ass with mobile gas, is a reference to Vonnegut's book, Breakfast of Champions.
No, it's not. Did someone say up your ass with mobile gas in the Vonnegut book?
I like how you just said, no, it's not, without knowing.
Well, I'm not Popeye.
Sadly, no Tony Medley for this one.
Yeah, I'm pissed at him for this, because this is right in the zone for him. He should have seen this movie. Coward.
Yeah.
Can we guess what Tony Medley would have thought?
Oh, 2 out of 10.
He would have hated Jack Black, right? Like, doesn't like Jack Black. Doesn't find him funny.
I don't think he likes Ben Stiller either, right?
He would have questioned why Rachel Weisz would
stoop so low.
He'd, like, make a lot of Rachel Weisz, like, remarks about how hot she is. And then just question, like, why would she choose to do something like this?
I don't know, guys. Tony Medley believes in all environments. And he's going to say it.
He doesn't like Ben Stiller. I'm reading a Starsky and Hutch review from 2004. And he says half of it is pretty good. The Owen Wilson half.
Wow.
Bad casting isn't limited to Stiller. Wow. Oh, yeah. And then, of course, he doesn't like Vince Vaughn. He reviewed Hotel Rwanda, but not Envy. Huh. He liked Hotel Rwanda.
Yeah, I bet he did. Oh, genocide.
10 out of 10.
Kill them all.
Goodness.
That's not me. That's Tony Medley said that. Damn it, man. That's twice in one podcast.
Jesus.
Well, I mainly eat out of a dumpster.
I should try that. I need some new dresses.
Don't. Or if you do, stay away from the one in Ocean and Wilshire. That's mine. Seriously. Stay out of it.
Golden Dumpster nominees. Naming the idea, Va-Pod-Rize. It's just a good name. Jack's kid striking out at T-ball. Amy Poehler deciding to run for the Little Congress. Ben going off on his boss at work. Walk-ins, good for you, good for you. The alias Elmo Karp, pool rep. J-Man's career, he worked at a pretzel kiosk, he was a limo driver, coal miner, drove a yogurt truck for 6 months, and is an independent contractor, and the freight train hog-obsessed Italian minister in the hot tub.
I'll go first. I'm going to go with the rant about flan. I guarantee you none of them have ever heard of your big show off flan or flan or whatever you want to call it that you have to have every night of the week.
For me, it's good for you, good for you. It'll always be funny to me. It makes me laugh quite hard. The J-Man. He's the J-Man.
Man, this is tough for me. because I really want to go with the J-Man, but I think I'm going to give it to Rachel Weisz.
Windsong? That was my backup. Like, it's Aunt Windsong, and you know that.
It's her checking Ben Stiller. So it's like the glare whenever there's opulence in front of them, or when it looks like Va-Pod-Rize is going to be a hit. It's the Windsong thing. It's when he's like, you want me to go get him? I'll go get him. She's okay. Yeah, I've got some questions. It's just her always making him explain himself. Like, I think Rachel Weisz is just amazing in this.
Breathe in through nose, out the mouth.
Ass on, ass off.
Teddy Rex, Moosey Teddy Rex. Teddy Rex, Moosey Teddy Rex.
Ass on, fucking ass off. Ass on, fucking ass off.
This is a tough one because there's a lot of ass off candidates and not really any ass on candidates. Like, I'm going to pick one that feels kind of cheap.
Yeah, I don't agree with Mayes saying ass on for a couple.
I had Hector Elias as Eduardo, the butler.
No.
I had Edith Jefferson as Mabel, the woman that answers the door when Amy Poehler is going door to door to canvas.
No, where does the poo go?
And I had Maricela Ochoa as the vet, Dr. Fernandez.
The Dr. Fernandez might be my pick, but I feel like it's very cheap because it's like three lines.
I think it's the neighbor. I think it's the one who answers the door.
I'm going with the vet. The vet was just, I thought it was just a little too over the top, even though I love the little... A lethal poison. Little person. That's
very nice. I'll go with Maricela Ochoa as the vet, Dr. Fernandez. Ass on.
That's fine. I'm not going to fight back on that. I'll sweep it.
That's fine.
That's not how it works.
Ass off. That's going to be tougher. I would say Rachel Weisz, even over Walken. I don't know if that's controversial.
Jack and Ben both have their moments, but it's Christopher Walken to me because he brings it in every single scene. He's a J-Man.
We know what the misogynist is going to go with.
Jack Black.
Whoa.
Jack Black. Well, who do you think I was going to go with?
Oh, Walken.
What does that have to do with misogyny?
Well, definitely I could go with the woman.
Oh.
Which he didn't. I mean, you're going Jack Black.
No, Jack Black. That means Jack Black. Like, it just like everything he does is so exuberant. Like I said, in the infomercial, he's like, no muss, no fuss.
You know what? All right.
What am I supposed to do with this?
The infomercial, you sold me on the infomercial. I'll go Jack Black as well.
All right, there it is.
Misogyny is cool.
Time for phobe or file. Amin, you picked it, motherfucker.
Yeah, this is the worst kept secret. Every time I like talk about the movie earlier in the pod, I always say to myself, like, don't give it away. Like, give it some mystery. You haven't watched it in a while. Maybe you forgot. Maybe it's not as good as you remember. But like, I couldn't do it. I can't hide my feelings toward this thing. This thing is a full blooded file for me, just straight up and down, erect, salute, everything. Like, yo, this movie's awesome. I love everybody in it so much that it was too hard for me to find someone acting their ass on. I'm shocked that 8% is what the critics thought. I'm even more shocked that only 27% is what the people thought.
Yeah, they're wild.
You're all fucking sheep. Shout out to this movie. I love it.
It's an easy.
I owned it.
You owned it from Hollywood Video. It's an easy file for me. I love this movie. The first time I watched it, I also owned it. It was on DVD that I think I just bought from like a Target or something, but I also owned it for a very long time. Everyone in it is good. Everyone's funny. I can't believe it's as poorly received as it is. I think you're an idiot if you don't like this movie. I just remember back when we started Cinephobe, when we were having the idea for it, Amin came to me with this movie. I thought, yes, this has to be a Cinephobe movie. This is why we're creating the podcast. So yeah.
Second half of this movie is tough, man. It is pretty bad. The whole quote unquote Italy sequence is pretty weird.
I don't like the newscast kind of views of it.
The last part where we've literally got a dead horse floating up the river that's been missing for God knows how long. And then we're rushing to get an autopsy. And then we realize that when Va-Pod-Rize is sprayed on poop, it becomes a lethal poison, which never came up at any point in the 18 months, even though all you do is spray it on poop. And the EPA never tested it. No one ever tested this product. They just sold billions. The whole planet would be dead. Everybody be dead. It'd be Va-Pod-Rized.
You would be surprised what doesn't get tested is on the market.
But he's the J-Man. It's a file. Sweep it, boys.
Make sure you're tweeting us your picks for ass on, ass off. Golden Dumpster, Phobe, or File. You can drop it in the Discord if you're a Patreon subscriber, patreon.com/countthedings. Make sure you get all that extra content, including all the holiday movies. Also, you can tweet us at Darth Amin, at Talk Hoops, at Corn Puzzle on the old Twitter machine, your Phobe, or File, your Golden Dumpsters, and your Ass On, Ass Off.
Zach, you didn't file Soul Man?
No, I went with what you went with.
That's right.
That was the one where I was real worried that you were going to try to trick me into a file. And I just decided I'll go with whatever Amin says. If I had filed it on my own, that's racist. If I had filed it because you filed it, probably racist. Pandering, you know? You didn't file Soul Man?
No, I didn't. No, it wasn't even close. Pretty racist movie.
Next time we make love, you introduce me to Jade.
Whose pick is up next?
It's Mayes. Mayes, what's your pick?
No matter how much Peter loved her, what made the pan refuse to grow was that the hook brings you back. We're doing Hook.
Woo!
We got a special guest.
Special guest?
I'm glad we went through all that because I was lost. I was like, what?
You didn't know what the fuck you started.
Also, Mayes doing a Peter Pan movie. I'm like, come on, man. Like, the material writes itself.
Those lost boys won't be lost anymore.
Oh, boy.